So welcome back. I'm Joanna Marsh. I'm a staff reporter here at Freight Waves, and we're at this fireside chat, a rail shipper's perspective on the last mile. And I have here with me Brad Hildebrand. He is a vice president at Cargill, and he's the global rail and barge lead. So welcome, Brad. Thank you so much for joining us, and we appreciate having you here.
Thank you. Welcome, Joanne.
Yeah, great. So I guess if you could tell me a little bit about yourself, what you do at Cargill, and also, a little bit of the company too, what sort of products you ship via rail and maybe some of the other transport modes as well.
Sure, thanks. I'm, again, Brad Hildebrand. I'm the global lead for rail and barge for Cargill Incorporated. I've got responsibilities for helping manage two of our modes of transportation here at Cargill, both rail and barge. As it relates to the rail portion of my job, I have responsibilities for working with all the major railroads here in North America to ensure that our needs are being met as a shipper, and that we're building and developing relationships to further the transportation of our goods, and make sure that we're providing adequate service to our customers.
Okay, yeah, great. Sounds good. I thought it'd be nice just to give a brief introduction about who the railroads are, just for people who might not be as familiar with the rail industry. So we have seven Class 1 railroads in North America, two in Canada, although they have operations in the United States, and five in the United States. And the Class 1s they earn a lot of revenue and in the billions, but they also spend a lot of that money as well. And in recent years, they've, most of them except BNSF, have deployed precision scheduled railroading, and I know that's raised some questions among shippers about service. And so I guess if you could explain to me a little bit about PSR, that stands for precision scheduled railroading, what effect that has had for you as a rail shipper, and anything else you'd like to share about that.
Sure. So as you mentioned, there are seven Class 1s in the United States and North America, I should say. Two in Canada, the Canadian Pacific, Canadian National. In the east, there's the CSX and the Norfolk Southern. In the west, there's the Union Pacific and the BNSF Railroad. And then a seventh railroad, the Kansas City Southern, which basically goes from Kansas City on down through Texas and on into Mexico. The PSR, as you mentioned, is a methodology that has been employed by a number of the carriers here in North America to help improve not only their operating efficiencies, but also, let's face it, their profitability. I was quoted in Wall Street Journal once when I was in testifying before the Surface Transportation Board, which is the government regulatory body, as saying a PSR is really nothing more than doing less with less. And it's important to point that out in that the railroads are really looking to optimize their networks to ensure that they're efficiently moving the cars, which is always good. But they're also streamlining their operations through trying to reduce the amount of excess cars that are out on the network, to really limit and manage the flow of cars in and out of their yards. But basically, it's one of trying to eliminate a lot of undue expense would take to move cars from A to B. And so the hope and the prayer and the promise with PSR has always been, we'll improve the overall efficiencies of our network, And in exchange for that efficiencies, we will become more consistent as a railroad operator. And so through consistency, then you can become more dependent on us and our service to move your goods from A to B.
Okay. And since this summit is about the last mile, the first and last mile, what's Cargill's interest in the last mile? I think, you know, people lots of times, you know, if they do think about the railroads, it might be, you know, e-commerce or intermodal, but what does an ag shipper have an interest in first and last mile movements?
Yeah, so I'll liken it to a package that I just got from Amazon today. Mm-hmm. It was some shoes that I ordered, and you know, you could track those shoes through the Amazon network, and it was finally delivered here to my home on my doorstep this afternoon. So think of the first mile or the last mile, they're synonymous depending upon which end of the supply chain you're in, as that package of shoes moving through the Amazon network and finally moving from a warehouse or distribution center here in the Twin Cities, since I live in Minneapolis, to being put onto a truck and then finally that package being delivered to my door. So the same thing happens with the railroads, right? We ship from an origin to a destination, and the railroads provide that service of getting the cars from your origin to the final destination. But at the origin side, cars are either coming in or coming out of your facility, depending upon whether you're, well, if you're loading or unloading. But the railroads will move cars to a serving yard very close to your facility, your plant or elevator, as the case of Cargill, and will schedule periodic moves of those cars into your facility. The railroads schedule service to you depending upon how many cars you load or unload on a weekly basis. Sometimes you'll get service 7 days a week if you're a very busy facility and you're loading a lot of cars, to as few as 1 day a week if you're a much smaller facility. So if you think about it, you're really reliant on the railroad to provide consistent service on the days of the week that they're supposed to be serving you. When they show up, everything's great, right? I was expecting to get my cars in on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, so 5 days a week. As long as the railroad shows up and I get my cars, you know, I can plan my schedule at my plant or elevator to match up with what I expect from the railroad. However, if they fail in that, right, now all of a sudden I was expecting cars to come in, and now all of a sudden the railroad calls up and says, sorry, we're not going to be able to serve you today. There is a gap in our pipeline, or there's a gap in our service. Well, depending upon what I was making on that day or what I wanted to ship in or ship out, right, it kind of totally upsets your plans for the day. And then it leaves you scrambling, right, to have to try to make up for that either by processing inventory if you've got that available to you, or loading your product into kind of a holding bin, so to speak, if you're a bulk shipper, or stuffing more stuff into your warehouse waiting for the next switch to show up. So you can imagine that if that doesn't happen periodically, right, it just kind of throws a wrench into your plans. And so then, you know, as a shipper, you're left kind of scrambling to figure out, okay, what am I going to do on that day that I didn't get the service that I was expecting? And depending upon the time of the year and the kind of business you're in and industry you're in, you know, sometimes you can, as I mentioned, handle, you know, a day or two without problem. But if it extends on past that, then all of a sudden you don't have inbound ingredients to manufacture, or all of a sudden your space and your facility is filling up, and now all of a sudden you have to shut your doors or slow down. So the first mile, last mile becomes a critical element if you think about the whole supply chain. And it's really where the game is won and lost. If that's done well and consistently, you're able to plan and manufacture your goods, and they're going to get to your customers without issue, and they're going to be able to receive them. And hopefully on their end, right, so they're at the other end of the spectrum in the supply chain, they'll get those goods in and they'll move on a normal schedule, and they'll be able to unload them, process them, and do the kind of things that they need to do.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And so I guess if you could kind of quickly explain to me, Cargill is part of a group with other shippers who have asked the STB for some more, for them to collect more data, rail service data, on the last mile. And could you kind of quickly explain to me what's that about, and also maybe perhaps explain like what sort of data the STB collects right now?
Sure. The Surface Transportation Board, the STB that you mentioned, is currently collecting information weekly from the railroads regarding their overall velocity. So how fast are they moving on their network? How often are their cars sitting in railroad yards as they're moving through the system? How many cars in general of the different products that they're actually moving within a period of time? So there's a whole host of different metrics that the railroads are providing to the STB. However, one metric that they're not providing, back to this first mile, last mile, is really how well are the railroads performing against their promise, if you will, on what they're going to provide you as a shipper. What is their batting average, so to speak, and how often are they showing up on the days that they're supposed to show up? And there's no metric in place today that the railroads are providing to the STB to measure their performance on that first mile, last mile service. And it's something that we as Cargill and part of the National Industrial Transportation League, or NITLE, have talked to the STB about adding as an additional measure. As far as a shipper goes, really the game is won and lost in that first mile, last mile. And if that's not being done well, it really, as I mentioned earlier, can have a huge impact on your overall operations. And so we think it's a very critical measure, and one that we would highly recommend be added to the STB's list of required metrics that they receive from the carriers. A number of carriers currently measure this in normal course of operation, and so we don't think that this would be a huge burden for the railroads to add this to the list of things that they're already providing to the STB. And it would help us, and the STB for that matter, begin to measure and monitor how well the railroads are performing in a given time, and how are they doing from quarter to quarter, year over year. And it would give us a very good snapshot of how effective are they. And again, this whole notion around precision schedule railroading was that they would take out a lot of the inefficiencies in the system, which would allow them to better serve their customers. And so along the way, right, is the promise that if that's the case, then you should be able to be more consistent, not only in how fast you move us from A to B, but how often and how accurate are your first mile, last mile switching performance. And so we think it goes hand in glove with the other measures that the STB is asking the railroads. And as I mentioned, we believe the game is really won and lost there on the first mile and the last mile.
Yeah, okay. Is there anything you really want to say, Brad? Is there anything you want?
I think that the metric that is of most interest to us is the one that we just described, or I just described, is that first mile, last mile. And so that's okay. Would be a good ad for the STB.
Okay, well, great. Well, thank you, Brad, for your time again. I really appreciate it. And I hope you have a good rest of the day.